Goss's book. I hope I said her name right. Or Goss. The Strange Case of the Alchemist's Daughter. And we'll just do a little bit of this tonight. Some of it may be inaudible. But it's a great. Speak for her. And Mrs. Barstow agreed to take her back. first it would bark. Mr. Utterson, said Mary. Mrs. Poole, I'm completely mystified. Why would Mr. Utterson have been involved in this affair? Well, he was your mother's solicitor at the time, said Mrs. Poole. Said Diana, once again pushing her big toe into the hole in the sofa and giving it a good tear. But Mr. Guest didn't know about any of those arrangements, said Mary. Why would Mr. Utterson have not informed his own clerk? Perhaps Mr. Utterson didn't trust him, said Mrs. Poole. Would you? Not as far as I could throw him, said Mary. Diana, have I done the he said, she said enough? Her mother must have known about her father and the experiments about Hyde. Mary imagined Mr. Utterson in his somber frock coat and black top hat, with the gold chain of his pocket watch just visible, getting into a hansom cab and ordering it to take him to Barstow's. The cabbie must have grinned to indicate that he understood what a gentleman such as Mr. Utterson would be doing there. It would have been so disdainful. Shuddering. He must have been acting for her mother. Mary had wondered how her mother, who was already ill, had managed to set up a bank account and bring Diana to the Magdalen Society. This explained it. The lawyer had done it all. And of course, Mrs. Jekyll could not have gone to a whorehouse to pick up the daughter of her husband's assistant. Or if Mary's hypothesis was correct, her husband's daughter. Resembled a jigsaw puzzle. One corner of it was starting to fit together to show a picture, but there were so many other pieces that had no places as yet. Beatrice, Rappacini, the poor girl this morning with her brain cut out, S.A., whatever that meant. So are there more sandwiches? Asked Diana. Since Mrs. Poole declared early in the process say you're 14, but you behave like a child, had its effect. Diana lay tucked into bed in what had once been Mary's nursery, and Mary collapsed into a chair in her own bedroom. She was so tired. Once her days had passed quietly, one after another, in the routine of caring for her mother. She had ordered meals, responded to the nurse's complaints, paid bills that once had been only a fortnight ago. In that fortnight, her life had changed completely, and she had the disquieting sense that it would continue to change, perhaps in ways that were not particularly pleasant. She had longed for adventure, and now that it was happening to her, she was not sure how she felt about it. Today, she had been to Whitechapel, seen a corpse, and gained what was presumably a sister. What would tomorrow bring? The most difficult part, the part she did not want to think about quite yet, was the revolution that day had made in her memories of her father. The tall, kind, distant father she had known, at least he had not been a Dr. Rappacini experimenting on his own daughter, or daughters, because there was, after all, Diana. Was Diana, in a sense, the product of his experiments? Why had Hyde wanted a child and a girl, specifically? Perhaps he had simply been jealous of his alter ego and wanted a daughter of his own. If Dr. Jekyll had married, then he would have Diana. Or was there something more nefarious behind it? Those thoughts went around and around in Mary's head. Would it never stop aching? She should have asked Mrs. Poole for something, one of those patent medicines the housekeeper kept in her dispensary. But Mary did not want to wake her or make a trip downstairs through the dark house. There was nothing to do but get some sleep. She pulled on her nightgown and slipped between the covers. The nursery was next to her bedroom, and until she fell asleep, Mary could hear, through the walls, Diana snoring. It was a strangely comforting sound. The next morning, Diana was up before she was. Mrs. Poole had dressed her in one of Mary's old dresses, which would have been given to Alice in another year. Her own clothes will need to be washed, said Mrs. Poole, though I don't know what good it will do. I've never seen dresses that have been mended so many times. They're about to come apart at the seams in such a cheap material, that scratchy gray wool. Thank goodness her coat is in a reasonably decent shape. And I've made her polish her boots, but I've had to give her a pair of your gloves and one of your hats. After of toast, eggs, and coffee as a particular treat for Diana. Coffee, heavenly coffee, Diana sang, dancing around the morning room, and Mary had to admit that she had a good singing voice. They walked first to the bank where Mrs. Jekyll had kept an account for Diana, and then to the Bank of England to transfer funds. £35, 5 shillings, 3 pence, in what was now Mary's own account. She withdrew a pound in change and put it into her purse. Oh, to have money in her purse again, Mrs. Poole would be able to buy sugar. And perhaps there would be a jelly roll for tea. And then, with Diana complaining that her boots pinched, they made their way to the Royal College of Surgeons to see the poisonous girl. Chapter 8. The Poisonous Girl. She sighed, remembering when she had barely left the house for fear that her mother might suffer another of her attacks. Thank goodness for Nurse Adams, who had been so reliable, although very expensive. And here she was, after a long walk from Threadneedle Street. Somehow she had expected Lincoln. used to be fields, but as so often in London, the name was deceptive. It was simply a park surrounded by streets lined on two sides with respectable buildings in the Georgian style. On the other two sides were Lincoln's Inn, where barristers plied their trade, and the Royal College of Surgeons. As she and Diana walked through the park under a canopy of ancient oaks, Mary remembered the park she had seen yesterday in Whitechapel, with poor children playing in ragged clothes. How strange that the word park could describe such different places. The rain had stopped, but whenever the wind blew, which was often, large wet drops would fall on their heads from the branches above. Mary kept her umbrella up and tried to cover both of them, but Diana always walked either ahead or behind her, not caring whether she got wet. As they left the park, they saw the facade of the Royal College of Surgeons with its gray columns, looming like a great mausoleum. There was already a line of visitors stretching down the stone steps. Mary could see respectable men in frock coats and bowler hats, mothers with children pulling at their hands and asking if they could go play in the park. Maids on their days off, boys in dirty trousers who would obviously not be able to pay the entrance fee but probably hope to sneak in and catch a glimpse of the poisonous girl before they were ejected by the porters. She checked to make sure she had the advertisement with her folded into her purse. "Are you here to see the poisonous beauty?" asked a young man with a sparse attempt at a mustache, presumably one of the porters. He had an official look about him and was holding a sheaf of pamphlets in his hand. When Mary nodded, he told her to line up behind the others. At 10 a.m. precisely, the line began to move. The visitors who had been waiting filed into the entrance hall, handing the porter either an advertisement or the required number of shillings and pence. In return, he handed them a pamphlet. Mary glanced at it quickly. At the top of the page was written, "The Poisonous Girl, a Wonder of Modern Science, discovered by Professor Petronius M.D. DPhil, a member of the Anthropological Institute of Great Britain and Ireland." She did not have time to read the rest. The line was filing past a set of stairs marked "To Library," and through a pair of doors that opened into a large chamber. In the middle of the chamber was a wooden platform with a table on it. On the table was a collection of objects. Mary had no time to pay them closer attention, although she noticed that one was a canary in a cage. "Now that's more like it," said Diana, turning and staring upward. The chamber was two stories high, with a balcony running around it. On both the first and the second floors, the walls were lined with wood cabinets. Through their glass fronts, Mary could see anatomical specimens of various sorts, skeletons, but also row after row of glass jars filled with what were presumably parts of a human body. It looked like the pantry of a frugal housewife who, instead of pickles, had put up heart said, "Make way. Make way for Professor Petronius." The crowd parted, and a man in a theatrical black coat with enormous side whiskers too black to be entirely natural walked to the platform. He looked around at the audience, clearing his throat once or twice, while the crowd quieted down and waited expectantly. And then he spoke in a voice that carried to the back of the room. "Ladies and gentlemen, I am Professor Petronius. Welcome to this august institution which has so generously allowed me to reveal to you one of the scientific wonders of our age. A marvel out of the classical world, when such a phenomenon was known, although it astonishes us to see it in the 19th century. Today I will show you a young woman as beautiful and innocent as a rose in bloom, whose system has been so imbued with poisons that she herself has become poisonous to all she touches. Imagine, ladies and gentlemen, not being able to touch, to kiss another human being for fear of harming them, of rendering them lifeless. Imagine being so deadly that your fellow men shun you once they learn of your powers. Today, you shall see just such a creature, separated forever from others of her kind. She is not a monster, no. For unlike the elephant man or bear woman of whom you have no doubt heard, she was not born with her peculiarity. The poison was introduced into her system slowly over a period of many years, as you may read in my article, a copy of which you hold in your hands, originally published in the Journal of Anthropological Institute. Beatrice Rapacini is not a monster, but a marvel of modern science. Behold." He flung out his right arm, pointing towards the entrance. There stood a woman about Mary's age, dressed in white with the rest of the audience. Mary gasped. Even Diana, who was usually unimpressible, whistled under her breath. She was beautiful. She was, it was no exaggeration to say, the most beautiful woman most of the audience members had ever seen. Her dress was in the Grecian style, leaving her neck and arms bare. Her skin of a soft olive hue proclaimed her a daughter of the temperate south, and her cheeks were tinged with red, as though she had spent time under a southern sun. Her features were as clearly cut as those of an ancient statue. Her hair, a lustrous black, hung down to her waist. She stood still for a moment, then walked toward the platform, swaying as gracefully as one of the reeds so admired by the classical god Pan. "That's a lovely description, Catherine. Thank you. I'm glad someone notices when I write particularly well." "Let her through, let her through," said Professor Petronius. "Mothers, nurses, if you please, protect your children. Make certain they do not touch her, not even the hem of her gown. Remember that she is deadly." The audience parted before her like the Red Sea, some of the mothers pulling their children back sharply as she passed, although the children strained to see her. "Poor girl," thought Mary. "Surely this Petronius is both cruel and a charlatan. She could not possibly harm those children." And indeed, as she moved through the crowd, the woman's face was so sad that Mary would have liked to comfort her. "Is that truly what you thought when you first saw me?" Beatrice said. "More or less, although you know how Catherine romanticizes everything. But I was thinking about how sad you looked." "Beatrice, I was. Oh, indeed. I was so sad that you could not imagine the depths of my sadness." The woman stepped onto the platform and stood beside Professor Petronius. She looked out at the audience calmly and with an expression. famous doctor specializing in the vegetable poisons. He knew how to draw their properties and turn the deadliest toxins into the most beneficial pharmacopoeia. His daughter tended his garden of poisonous plants so she could tend them properly with the attention that most delicate specimens required. He forbade her from protecting herself with gloves or masks. Slowly, as she assisted her father in his experiments, she herself became poisonous. The essence of the plants seeped into her, and as she grew them into splendid womanhood, she also grew deadly to man. And now, said Professor Petronius, you shall see how deadly Miss Rappaccini can be. From the vase on a table, he lifted a Madonna lily, a long stem of white flower, no doubt forced in the hothouse since it was before the season for them. Ceremoniously, he handed it to the woman, to be sure. She took it in her hand, held it for a moment, then opened her mouth and breathed on the flowers. Almost at once, they began to turn brown, to shrivel and dry up. Their petals fell to the floor. Then the stem itself turned brown and was simply a dry stick. The audience gasped. In quick succession, as the audience stood spellbound, Professor Bertonus handed Beatrice a variety of living objects. An apple on its branch rotted from her breath. Bees in a jar that had been buzzing a moment before fell silent and lay on the glass bottom, their wings twitching, then still. A mouse Professor Petronius handed her. Mary noticed that he donned gloves before doing so, scampered up her arm, stopped on her shoulder, then stood as though transfixed. She lifted it off and kissed it tenderly before laying it back on the table, where it did not move. A small green snake that he lifted out of a box wound itself around her wrist. In a few minutes, she unwound it and returned its limp form. Finally, Professor Petronius held up the canary in its cage. Beatrice touched the cage gently with one hand. There were tears in her eyes as she leaned forward and breathed on the unfortunate bird. A moment before, it had been cheeping. It gave a final querulous cheep, and then it too was silence. Beatrice turned away as though she did not want to see either the destruction she had caused or the reactions of the audience. Who will volunteer to approach and feel the power of Miss Rappaccini's breath? Asked Professor Petronius. We need a robust gentleman who is willing to risk his life for a kiss from the poisonous beauty. Gentlemen, if you volunteer, Miss Rappaccini will kiss you on the cheek, and you will feel her power. But do not volunteer if you have a heart condition or your medical advisor has forbade you from taking vigorous exercise.